Hello everyone and welcome back to the video. Today I'm going to be finally presenting a 1v1 Arabia tier list on the new patch, and it's the perfect timing because King of the Desert 5, a $80,000 1v1 tournament just finished. And if you want to see my performance in that tournament, check out my secondary channel, Hera Gameplay, link in the description. I posted my sets from that tournament onto that channel, so you guys can go see how I did and see the gameplay from my point of view. And yeah, we're going to go ahead and hop right into the tier list, but first, let's get Twitch chat to say hi in the chat right now to YouTube. If you guys want to come check me out on Twitch, of course, link of that is in the description. Live streaming almost every day. And it's a really good time down here on the Twitch side of things. So they're saying hi right now. And we're about to hop into the tier list. But as you can see, let the names fly. Let the hello YouTubes come. Say hi to your mom. You're famous. You'll catch the video later. And let's hop into the tier list now. So guys, this is going to be a tier list about the top Arabian civilizations, of course, and there's 42 of them to rank. This is not with the Romans because Romans are not unranked, and it's honestly hard to rank the Romans anyways, but we're gonna rank the other ones. And if I can zoom in here, oh, that could be pretty fantastic. A little bit more here, there we go, that should be a little bit better. Okay, so yeah, we're going to start alphabetical order, and I've got my tier list S, A, B, C, D. Just to explain for those who might be new to my tier list how it works, the guys at the top, S tier, are the consistently amazing civilizations on Arabia. They are good no matter what, you know, civ they're up against. They're good in all kinds of situations. They're very consistent. They're very powerful, etc. The civs that are in the middle are usually pretty good in some cases, not in other cases. They have some things missing, but they have some really good strengths. And then the civs at the bottom have terrible matchups, very little going for them, and they're awkward to play, amongst other negative things. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and hop right in to the best 1v1 Arabia civilizations on the current patch. Starting off with the Aztecs, this is a civilization that has notoriously been at the top of the ladder. However, in recent times, and especially on this patch, I really don't see it being at the top. It's probably going to be somewhere in the A tier, and I'm fairly confident in that. Now, the strengths of Aztecs is it's a mesociv, so it has eagles, but that comes at a downside. No cavalry. It has great monks and great infantry in general. The recent gambesons give it a pretty big buff, going into the late game. Some extra options with the champion line being a bit stronger. But overall, I think Aztecs aren't broken, but aren't bad. They're actually quite strong. I recommend you guys play Aztecs if you love the civ, because then it's going to be quite good. But if you don't like the civ, don't feel like you're missing out. It's not broken, and it's not completely unfair. Next up, we've got the Bengali. Now, the Bengalis are interesting because they are really good in certain cases, and they're played a lot in maps like Arena and stuff like that, where it's a bit more closed. And so by the same logic, they can be somewhat decent in Arabia if the map's a little bit more closed. But because the maps tend to be a lot more open most of the time, you really don't have the time to build up into your power units like the elephant archers with the Bengali. And so for that reason, I'd probably have Bengali somewhere in the C tier. Also, the tier lists are organized like this, from S to D, but also left to right, left ones being the highest up in that particular category, and the ones at the right will be the lowest. So it's going to be a very detailed tier list. Next up, we got the Berbers. And honestly, with the Berbers, it's hard to say where exactly I rank them. It's once again one of the civilizations that is really strong when everything goes right, but they are somewhat predictable because they usually play towards cavalry in the mid game. They have very little other bonuses besides their stable units. And although those are powerful, it is a little bit more one-dimensional. Berbers are much better at lower level. So if you're watching this and you're lower level, Berbers are much higher up than where I'm going to put them. And in my opinion, a very good civilization for beginners who want to abuse cavalry. And especially with the discount, they're great. But even at the top level, the camel archers and a pretty solid late game make them a fierce competitor. And in my opinion, they're going to be somewhere probably towards the bottom of B tier. Next up, we got the Bohemians. And honestly, it's probably just going to be a D tier civ. I feel like Bohemians have very little going for them. And the only time they can thrive is if the map is pretty much closed and you get to set up till Castle Age. Chemistry in Castle Age can be kind of nice with hand cannoneer, but overall the civ pretty much dies to Night Skirm every single time. Very little chances for them to not die to Night Skirm. And they don't really have a lot of good options. They're not very flexible, and they're very easy to play against. They also have a lot of bad matchups, so it's going to be a D tier civ. Okay, next up we got the Britons, and It's going to be hard for me to place the Britons because it's one of those civs, once again, that if you get to play your game, they're very strong with their archers and stuff like that. But besides archer line, in the early game, they don't have any other options that are great. They could scout rush because they get the sheep bonus, but they really want to get the 3 TC playing with Expo, and they are more or less predictable when it comes to that. The late game is a little bit more fleshed out. You get to go for light cav or cavalier with full armor upgrades, or full blacksmith upgrades, and you do get some nice infantry going for you, but in my opinion, probably just going to be a B tier civ. Definitely higher than Berbers because it has more potential, but definitely some clear weaknesses there for the Britons, and they do have some bad matchups. Next up, we got the Bulgarians, and I would probably drop Bulgarians at either the bottom of C tier or the top of D tier, but I'll probably just drop them in the bottom of C tier. Bulgarians really don't have that much going for them. They're very predictable in the minute arm rush or any kind of early aggression. If they don't use that, they have very little bonuses. Their late game is pretty one-dimensional. They don't have a great answer to halbs that's not infantry, so usually Arbalest halb poses a very big threat to the Bulgarians. And I just feel like there's no stage in the game where you're really going to be able to take advantage of the civ. I feel like the civ definitely deserves a little bit of a buff somewhere. The Conic used to be scary, but I don't know if it got nerfed or anything, but it kind of got changed to a point where it's just like really easy to deal with in most cases. So for me, Bulgarians probably in C tier. That makes sense to me. Next up, we got the Burgundians. I think probably top of C tier. This might seem weird because we did see, you know, if you were following King of the Desert, the civ was picked a couple times by Mr. Yo and others. But in my opinion, Burgundians, they got nerfed a little too much for Arabia. They're still strong in Arena, and the nerfs were justified. But on Arabia, they're simply too slow to get going. Everything needs to be perfect for Burgundians to be strong. They have some potential. Remember, the C tier civs here are not terrible. They can still win games, and they can still be dangerous. But they're not nearly as well-rounded and as consistent as the other civs. And so, for Burgundians, if everything goes well, you have a really good map, you get to wall, get those eco upgrades, and then find yourself with Cavalier or Crossbow into Coutidier or some Monks and get the Relics, it could work really well. But think of it this way, you need to get the Relics, but you also need to play defensive early. So which one is it? You know what I mean? It's so hard to defend early and also get the map control to get the Relics, and it just doesn't function well. Next up, we got the Burmese. And for me personally, Burmese is a great civilization. At the middle of the pack. It's not going to be S tier, and it's not going to be a D tier, but it's like the perfect civilization to have in the middle. I'd probably put it above Berbers, though, just because I feel like they have a little bit more early game strength, and I value that quite high. But yeah, I think Burmese are solid overall, but with a clear weakness of not having the armor on the skirms, not having a good answer to archers and arbalests and cav archers long term. But they're run by pretty solid when you get them going. The early game is great. The free wood upgrades are really smooth. And the full monk tech tree, or close to full monk tech tree, minus heresy. But having the discount on top of that helps a lot in the messy games, to be honest. They also get siege engineers, and it's a pretty well-rounded civ, minus the fact that they die to archers. By the way, I just realized in the B tier, we have three civs that start with the letter B. So that's Byzantine should go there, I guess, as well. Anyways, that's not what this is about. Next up, we have the Byzantine. They're either top of B tier or somewhere in the bottom of A tier. I'm going to put them in the bottom of A tier, and I'll explain my reasoning. Now, Byzantines are a great civilization for a lot of people. They love the civ. It actually has a lot of potential, and it's very hard to play against. For me, a personal preference, I hate playing Byzantine. I feel like I lose initiative a lot of the time. I'm forced to react. I have some weaknesses that can be exposed. And overall, I feel like I never really get to play the game I want to play. And so that's my problem with Byzantine. But other than that, they have great counter units, like really good upgrades in the blacksmith. The discount is crazy good. The free town watch and town patrol is hella underrated. Like, that's actually really good for defense and to gain map control or to slowly gain vision on the map. And then the extra HP on the buildings helps you win every treb war pretty much. The late game is also very solid. So for me, Byzantine is definitely up there, but not for me. Like, not a civ for me. Next up, we've got the Celts. And yeah, unfortunately, probably another C tier civ. I don't know where I'd place them. Probably above Bengalis. They probably have a bit more potential than Bengalis, but I don't really see Celts doing too much. The Huang rush is figured out and easy to counter at this point. Usually you don't even have a good map to do the Huang rush, and Celts have very awkward transitions. Their late game is great, their early game is solid. Mid game is okay, but the transition between those ages, not the most effective, not the most easy to do. And finally, our first S tier civ, the Chinese. I'm not even going to hide that Chinese are fantastic. They have pretty much everything you want from a civilization. They have a good early game with a good economy. They have a wide open tech tree. It's easy to make the transition because you get the cheaper techs. And they also have like everything you'd want at all stages of the game. They've got bloodlines to help you get through feudal age and castle age. They've got camels. They've got decent monks. They've got, you know, really powerful armies in late game. They've got heavy camel, chukunu, arbalest, halberdier, cavalier, halbs again. They've got champions. They have everything you can possibly ask for and really good power spikes throughout the game. So for me, Chinese, definitely an S-tier civ. Might even be the best civ in the game right now on Arabia. But maybe not. We'll see. Yeah, and this tier list is for like high ELO. This is like what the actual tier list is. At lower ELO, stuff like Berbers is better. Stuff like Bengalis is lower. Stuff like Chinese is slightly lower or heavily lower, maybe depending on how low ELO we're talking about. Byzantine gets higher up, etc. And if you're lower ELO, it's going to be about preference. What your comfort pick is, what's easier for you. But this is just about high level and what the true tier list looks like. Next, we've got Cumans. Now, Cumans can be good if you can 2TC, get that rolling, but most of the time, you're not able to do that. I'll probably put Cumans at the top of C tier with the condition that if you get the 2TC rolling, they are very similar to Burgundians, where you have a really good economy, but you lose the full map control, so a lot of bad things can happen. But if you get some good games with Cumans, they can look extremely strong. So it's the kind of thing where high variance, hit or miss, but definitely dangerous. Have to respect it. Next up, we've got Dravidians. And I know the GL guys like Dravidians a lot, but in my opinion, Dravidians are just so easy to play against if you understand how the civ works. And in my opinion, it's going to be a bottom of B tier. The only reason I even put it this high up, in my opinion, is because it has good matchups against stuff like Aztecs, stuff like the other Meso-civs, stuff like Ethiopians, Britons. It matches up well against Archer civs. So it is good at countering Archer civs. But overall, as a civ, it's not well-rounded, it's not flexible, and it doesn't have good matchups across the board, and it's actually very easy to counter. So, at best, they're bottom of B tier. If they didn't have such good matchups against the higher-up civs, they'd be probably in the C tier somewhere. Next up, we've got the Ethiopians, and where to place the Ethiopians? I'm going to put them top of A right now. I honestly think this civ is fantastic. I went through a lot of phases where I liked Ethiopians and I hated them, but the more fast-paced the meta becomes, the better Ethiopians are. And right now, the meta is extremely fast-paced. Everyone's trying to up really fast, and Ethiopians can up very fast and afford anything they want because of the extra resources they get. Faster-firing archers are also really good, and in general, they scale to a very solid late game. Not having the armor on the cav can be problematic, but with the recent buff to Shotels, sometimes the Shotels can fill the role that cav usually fills, and so you'll be fine with that. And you still get the Hussar upgrade, so your cav isn't terrible in the late game. Your Siege Arbalest Hal play is phenomenal, though. So in my opinion, Ethiopians are great, and not only that, you also get camels, so they're a great civilization. Ooh, next up we got the Franks, and where do we place the Franks? They're pretty good. A little bit one-dimensional, maybe a little bit predictable, you know, in some ways. But I think the Franks have a great economy, and they're pretty flexible. The worst part about Franks is how one-dimensional their late game is. You almost have to play towards Paladin in most cases. Your other options are like Throwing Axemen, Hand Cannoneer, Halberdier or Champion, and Bombard Cannon, or Siege. But all of those like units I just mentioned don't really work that well in most cases. And, I think they're overall very solid. I'd probably put them in the A tier somewhere, either below or above Aztecs. It's definitely very close. I'll probably put them below Aztecs, though. But it's very close. Above Byzantine, though. Yeah. But Franks are solid. They kind of just die to a lot of the top civs, and crossbow camo can kill Franks pretty easily, so probably below Aztecs for that reason. Next up, we got the Goths, and well, the Goths are probably going to be somewhere lower on my list, but not that bad. They're actually decent. I'll probably put them at the bottom of B tier, but just above Dravidians. Probably not. I mean, to be fair, it's harder to play against Goths than Dravidians. Like, Goths have a little bit more to offer. The hunt bonus is actually really good. They could scale to a dangerous late game. I think Goths are pretty good, probably above Dravidians. Yeah, I actually like them. The reason why they weren't seeing that much play in KOTD is because they have a lot of weaknesses and they're pretty one-dimensional into the infantry. And so if you're actually just able to counter the infantry, you'll find how easy it is to play against the Goths. But I think they're pretty good, actually. Maybe, you know, maybe people could have tried them out a little bit more. Next up, we got the Gurjaras, and that is going to be a A-tier civ just behind Ethiopians. I actually thought I entered the tournament, guys, in KOTD. I entered the tournament thinking Gurjaras were actually pretty bad. I thought they were going to be somewhere in the mid-tier, something easy to play against. But the more I played against them and with them, the more I realized that this civ is actually very strong. It's nowhere near as OP as it was before, but it still has a lot of great options. And the compositions you get on are very solid and hard to play against. So for me, Gurjaras gets off to a good start, has a lot of options, gets to good compositions. There's really nothing wrong with it, and I'd put it right there at the top of A. But I will say, for those lower level players, it's a hard civ to play, and it's a bit awkward. It's a bit different than some of the other ones. So if you're not able to grasp Gurjaras, you can just pick any other civ and you'll be fine. All right. Hindustani is up next. And now Hindustani, guys, it's a civ that was at the top of the table for a while when they first came out. But I think they suffered somewhere like 6 or 7 nerfs. And the place they find themselves right now is quite low. I actually heavily dislike the civ. Hate's a strong word, but I hate how much I dislike the civ. And it feels like it's almost unplayable in some ways. It has a lot of options, but you can never get to those options because the eco bonus got nerfed very hard. The camels are strong yet predictable. You don't get access to knights, so you can't use knights when the time is right. The Ghulam is a fake threat. The Ghulam just doesn't work. It has too little HP. It dies too fast. It's too hard to get there because you don't have the good economy that you had before. The only strength this civ has is great camels and great late game and great late game options. So that's what the civ has. But as I mentioned, because your economy bonus got nerfed so hard recently, and the lack of early game options just makes the civ feel so weak. In my opinion, it is in the C tier somewhere. Like, probably right here. Maybe slightly better than Burgundians, maybe slightly better than Cumans. It depends on who you talk to. I mean, I'd probably pick them over Cumans still, but I'm not even sure about that. But yeah, like, Hindustani are just really not a good civ right now. And the stats in KOTD showed it. People thought it might have been good because it used to be good, but it had something like a 20 to 30% win rate in the entire tournament, including the qualifiers. So I know it looks crazy, but there's actually no justifiable way to put Hindustani any higher. They, if you think about the matchups, like, Burmese should outpace them. Berbers should be completely fine if they get to, like, castleage with camels. I think Berber camels with knights should be completely fine as well, with light cap to snipe as well. You know, Britons will destroy Hindustani. The Ghulam is not even a threat. You know, you just go champion, you're fine. Arbalest and longbow should destroy them in low numbers. And yeah, Dravidian should be fine as well. Goth should be fine. Just any civ usually is just fine against Hindustani. It only really works well if your opponent is being a bit stubborn on cav. Next up, we got the Huns. I never really liked the Huns for Arabia, but I think they're pretty okay. Never liked the Huns recently. I used to love them, but recently, not really feeling the civ too much. Has some pretty big weaknesses. Like, not making houses means that you're going to be open for most of the time. So yeah, it's a bonus, but it has its downsides. And in my opinion, I'd probably put Huns at the top of C tier. They're a good civ if you like them, if you like to play them, but they have a ton of weaknesses. And, it's the kind of thing where a lot can go wrong. You know, their late game is good with the Cav Archer Hussar, but definitely not the most well-rounded civ. Next up, we've got the Incas, and I'd probably put Incas in the S tier. I'm not even sure. They could be better than Chinese, to be honest. I'm going to put Chinese slightly higher. Chinese feel a bit more solid overall, than Incas, but Incas are damn good. I can't stress how good I think Incas are. Now, I think, you know, the Civ just can do everything. It has a good early game. It has slingers and castellage that stops any kind of infantry. Camukes and halbs will dominate any kind of cavalry. They have monks. They have all the upgrades that they need on that. They have decent siege. They have siege engineers. They have eagle warriors to raid with high pierce armor. They have arbalests with thumb ring. They have skirms with discount. All their food units, in fact, have a discount. And they even start with an extra llama. So there's really nothing that can go wrong. Also, the house bonus helps a lot in the early game. So they have a good early game, good options in mid game, excellent late game. This Civ has very little weaknesses. And like I said, it could be better than Chinese. I'm not sure yet, but it's in the S tier for sure. Next up, we got Italians. And that's going to be an easy top of B tier for now. There's some Civs that will pass it. But top of B tier for now, I think Italians are like the bread and butter of what a basic Civ is on Arabia. Small eco bonus, good options with Arbalest, Hussar, Light Cav, Bloodlines, Cavalier, no Halbs unfortunately, but you have some other decent option, decent Siege. They have a little bit of everything, but nothing quite special and nothing too bad. I'd probably put them below Britons actually, to be honest. Britons has more power than Italians. On the KOTD version, probably Italians are slightly better because Bloodlines is huge, but Britons might be slightly more powerful over Italians. But yeah, Italians are definitely quite solid overall. Next up, we got the Japanese. I am releasing a sick Japanese build order. The build order should drop the day after the tier list, and those are going to be absolutely sick. But yeah, the Japanese can have some insane early game aggression that can go on. And honestly, I'll probably put Japanese either in the top of B tier or in the bottom of A tier. I'll throw them in the bottom of A tier for now, but I can drop them down a little later. But Japanese have great Arbalest Hal play. They have a great early game with the cheaper, wood. And unlike Dravidians, they actually have Knights and Bloodlines. So they're like very similar as they have a great late early game like Dravidians, but they have much more flexible mid game. Harder to abuse Japanese, like it is easier to abuse Dravidians. And Japanese have great options in the late game. And Gambesons really give this civilization a pretty big boost. The Trebuchet unique tech got lower price as well, so that's a lot easier to get to. And yeah, these hammer towers have always been strong and pretty annoying. So for me, Japanese are definitely up there. Next up, we got Khmer. And for me, Khmer are probably the weakest of the S tier Civs. Or maybe one will be weaker than it in the S tier, but it's really strong. Khmer is extremely hard to play against. The house hopping bonus is amazing. The farm bonus is phenomenal. You have decent options throughout the game, but usually you have the tempo. Not needing a barracks makes your early game so strong. You get to either go range or stable. You can even delay it and see what your opponent goes for, and then you can just drop it yourself. Because you don't need a barracks, you always have extra res in the early game to do that. And it just has very little weaknesses. Like for me, Khmer is one of those Civs that only dies if it plays against a really strong Civ. Otherwise, it should be like super easy to find a good win or a good game with Khmer. Not much to say. Just a great overall Civ. Start to finish, solid stuff. Next up, we got the Koreans. Koreans, man, I don't like this Civ too much. I thought it had potential going to KOTD. The towers and the free tower upgrades is interesting, but the Civ is way too slow for the current meta. Has very little bonuses. The wood saving on the unit is nice, but only kicks in a bit later on. Doesn't do enough for your early game. So, and even like late game, you're lacking a lot of options, and it's a little awkward to play sometimes. So I would say Koreans have something going for it, but it's a little too slow-paced and a little too fragile for me personally. Probably put them right above Celts, but yeah, and nothing too special there. All right, next up, we've got Lithuanians. Now, this is going to be pretty controversial because Lithuanians was a highly contested pick in King of the Desert, but I honestly feel like it is not a great Civ at all. In fact, Lithuanians was one of the Civs I would wish my opponent takes early so I can pick a better Civ instead of it. They think it's good. I think it's bad. They pick it early. I pick something else early, and I'm feeling good about the situation. That was one of the key strategic moments in my drafts. I let my opponent have Lithuanians third or fourth, and I would take something much better than it. Don't get me wrong, Lithuanian isn't terrible or anything like that, but I honestly don't think it's anything that special and anything that good. I would probably rank it somewhere in the B tier, and I'll explain why. I'd probably rank it maybe below Berbers or above Berbers, somewhere around here. Maybe right here above Berbers, but again, that's close. I know that looks weird, but if you think about how Lithuanians want to play right now, they don't really function well as a civilization. I might make a video about this later. So for example, they used to have 150 free food at the start. So the game plan before was really easy. You get the 150 free food, you get the initiative in the early game, and then you try to go for the relics. That's the game plan. They have strong options. Now, they drop the initial food by 50. 100 food isn't bad, but it's not enough, I feel at least, to give you a significant advantage in the early game. The 50 extra on top of that was really important. You needed 150. 100 doesn't cut it to gain an early game advantage. And then going into the mid game, you want to get the relics, right? But then you also want to add TCs, because when you add TCs, you get an extra 100 food. But you can't add TCs and go for the relics at the same time in most cases. So usually with Lithuanians now, you end up with one or two relics. Whereas before, your game plan was to get four relics, and that was a little bit easier to achieve. And so for that reason, I feel like the civilization is now in a very awkward spot for Arabia, where either the game looks amazing, you get your TCs, you get your relics because your opponent's misplaying, and the civ just looks insane. You get the lightest, it's a great unit. You know, everything's great. But in practice, it doesn't really work out like that. You don't get access to the relics. If your opponent's competent and is ready to punish Lithuanians, he will take the relics from you or force you to fight a lot more. And imagine if he's a civ like Berbers or Burmese, he gets the free wood upgrades. He sees the relics. He's going to easily be able to, you know, capitalize on that. Italians, they get the savings per age, 75 early compared to the 100. Then they get even more. Lithuanians is just a civilization that just, in my opinion, doesn't quite fit a role or doesn't really have a good strategy to aim for that's consistent. It also lacks a very important upgrade, Blast Furnace, making it very weak in Halberdier Wars. So Halberdier Wars are a nightmare for Lithuanians. They lack the last armor on the halbs, and they lack +2 attack. So, any civ going halbs against Lithuanians will be completely fine. So yeah, Lithuanian is quite low compared to what you might expect, but I stand by it. Next up, we got the Magyars. Magyars are probably somewhere as well. I think Magyars have higher potential than these two civs. So I probably put Magyars here. They're quite similar to Huns, but their early game is much stronger with the cheaper scouts and the +1 attack. A lot more predictable than the Huns, for sure. And, definitely just predictable in general, but very powerful and a great late game as well. Next up, we got Malay. Ooh, Malay is another one that it's hard to place 100%, but I'll probably place it maybe right behind Gurjaras in the A tier. Maybe behind Aztecs. You can interchange it. I'll probably put it right here. I think this makes sense. I really don't like Malay in a lot of cases, but in the cases where Malay shines, they are great. The way I describe Malay is that they're amazing at stomping the lower tier civs. Like Malay Koreans, I played that matchup twice, impossible. Koreans lose every single time, nothing you can do about it. You get terrorized by longswords and karambits, and if you try to go expo war against them, they will beat you to it because they have the faster uptimes. But then when you compare Malay to like some of the top civs, like Malay compared to like Chinese, they can match the economy, they have more options, and usually Malay just get kind of outpaced in the mid game, and you don't really get a chance to use infantry, and without infantry, Malay is pretty much like old Malay, and that's not very good. So yeah, for me, Malay is really strong in certain cases, great against the lower tier civs, but has some weaknesses for sure. Next up, we got the Malians. Again, hard to know where to place the Malians. They might be the best civ in the game, honestly, right now, to be honest. They might actually be the best civ in the game. It's really close between Malians, Chinese, and Portuguese. I'm spoiling it, I know. But Incas is also close. I'll put Malians at the top for now. Yeah, I'll put Malians at the top for now. They are really, really insane. Like, the only game plan against Malians is to deny them the gold. If you can't do that, you most likely lose. The gold bonus that they got is absolutely wild. The Civ also has a lot of options and gets off to a really good start. The wood saving bonus as well, combined with the gold bonus, makes them insane. They get camels, they get really good late games. Yeah, I mean, not much to say. They get gunpowder, they get everything that you might need. Before, the problem was that they had an awkward late game, which is still true. But now, because you get to the late game so much faster, it's not awkward anymore. Because you get to your late game much faster, you usually have a forward position, you get chemistry right away, cannons are coming out, and the problems you had before are no longer there. Next, we had Mayans, and that's probably going to be bottom of S tier. You can put them over Khmer if you like them more. I personally prefer Khmer more, but it's very interchangeable. Both are still really, really strong. And yeah, for me, Mayans are great if you can wall early. And they have a lot of options, but with the one downside of not having redemption and not having any knights. So dealing with siege pushes can be difficult. Eagles are sometimes not enough to deal with that. So yeah, Mayans have some weaknesses, some small weaknesses, but overall have great, great matchups and great options. Next up, we got the Mongols, and that is going to land in the top of A tier. I absolutely love Mongols. Maybe that's biased because of how open KOTD Arabia was, and that's where I'm getting my love for Mongols. But even when I think back to like the ranked ladder and some of the other Arabia versions I've played, Mongols are really, really good and hard to play against. You get the initiative right away. You get to lure deer, and you know, you could even lame if you want to. The start is so consistent. You have the extra line of sight on the scout, so you get to find all your stuff, go lame, or you can push, you know, deer. You always get the initiative, you always can put the pressure, and then you can go for a really fast castle time behind that early pressure, and then the step lances with the extra HP is the nail in the coffin. That is your win condition, and a lot of people don't know that, but Mongols, you know, getting good early game damage, following it up with step lances is a great strategy. Against Cav Civs, you have Cav Archers and Mangadai that help out. Archer Civs, step lances, siege kills them. If you're playing as infantry Civs, then usually you can just use that early game momentum to prevent them from getting their infantry rolling. It's a really good Civ that, in my opinion, only dies to some of the top Civs or to when the opponent has a good map. These Civs can beat Mongols if they have a good map. Otherwise, not so much. Next up, we got the Persians, and I'd probably put Persians somewhere in the C tier, above Hindustani, surely. I hate Hindustani. Persians have camels at least, good start, seems good, but nothing too great. Poles, if everything goes right, it's a good Civ, but if things start to go wrong and you get pressured early, they fall apart insanely fast. Also, it's so hard to place fullworks or fullwork farms when your opponent is constantly pressuring you and you have to fight. It's just so hard to do that. Poles did get a couple nerfs, so they used to be really strong, but now they're very awkward to play and not worth going through that trouble, in my opinion. Definitely not terrible, and I think in lower level, poles are great. Like, lower level, poles go up a lot, but in higher level, it's very easy to abuse this Civ, and it's not nearly as strong as it was before. Good on other maps, though. And next up, we have Portuguese, and that is probably going to go in this third place slot. I think I'm pretty happy with this S tier list. I think the list looks good. No other Civ will go into the S tier. It's just these six that feel above the rest. Portuguese are fantastic. They have cheaper gold units, a discount on gold that affects knights, crossbows, some other gold units like siege. They also get the wood berry bonus, which helps them in the early game. And they have a great tech tree as well. Great late game, Fitoria comes in. So Portuguese are really, really strong. And you know what? You can prefer them over the first two if you want to. It's really up to you. But for me, these three in this order fit make sense. And these three right after them make sense as well. Next up, we got the Saracens. Probably put it at the right here. This is the perfect spot for Saracens. The market helps you out so, so, so much. But besides that, the Civ doesn't have that much. So you're very market reliant. But I think it's a great Civ. I think people should have picked this a little bit more in KOTD. It would have been great at punishing some of the open maps, some of the fragile bases, because you just melt through walls. You also have a really good tech tree with the Saracens. You get camels with Zilatry. You get Mamluks in the late game if you need them. Ton of options. You get gunpowder. So the market is the core of the Civ, but market helps you get through the entire early and mid game. And after that, it's just about playing off those timings and setting up a good late game. So probably should have gotten picked more, but it had a good showing. Next up, we got Sicilians. And Sicilians. At first, I really liked the Civ. Then the more I played them, the more I felt like it doesn't do much versus the top tier Civs. It just dies out. So like Sicilian feels great against some of the mid tier Civs, but against any of the top two rows, they literally just get melted. Like maybe they can take on Byzantine, but everything else would just destroy Sicilians in most cases. So I'll probably put Sicilian somewhere in the C tier. I still probably prefer them to Poles. The early start with the dungeon can be nice, definitely. They have some decent mid-game options, but their late game is pretty fragile. They're not that special, and I don't know. I really don't think that Sicilians are that good, but yeah, they definitely have some options going for them, for sure. Next up, we got the Slavs, and Slavs should be, probably pretty low on the list. Probably D tier. But then again, if they're D tier, I'm gonna have to drop Bulgarians as well. I'm so sorry, guys. So Slavs and Bulgarians will join the D tier. Slavs just don't have that much going for them. They have knights, sure. They have good cav, sure. Good infantry, sure. Their economy doesn't really kick in that much. The buffs that Slavs get, like free gambesons, is not that impressive, honestly. I just feel like Slavs are very easy to play against, and they're very awkward to make work. That being said, you can still win with Slavs. It's not like an unplayable Civ, but yeah, just not the best one. Next up, we got the Spanish. Spanish did get a pretty big buff, and in my opinion, stand on a decent spot. I'll probably put them at the bottom of B tier. I'm happy with that. Things can go really right with Spanish, and things can go really wrong with Spanish. I think the bonus they got makes them feel very flexible in the early game and gives you a lot of cool plays and a lot of cool options. Conquistador is still strong, but weak to crossbow and skirmisher now that it lost a pierce armor, but still good in low numbers, of course. And I think Spanish is still pretty fine. Next up, we got the Tatars. That's going to be an easy A-tier Civ, probably right above the Franks. It's very similar to Franks in how it has a decent early game and a good mid game. But it has a better late game than Franks, and it has more options than Franks. So even though Franks might be more powerful with how they get the Paladin and stuff, Tatars have many more options, with Kashik being really strong, the Hussars with extra pierce armor being strong, Thumb Ring for free is good power spike, Cav Archer is very solid, and it has Camel, so it's a good Civ. Very flexible Civ. Next we have Teutons, and out of the bad Cavalry Civs, Teutons probably feel like they're up there as one of the best. I'd probably put them above Celts, but not higher than Koreans. Too slow for Arabia. They get outpaced by most civilizations, so I really don't see them doing too much. And Turks, probably bottom of B tier. Maybe above Spanish. Maybe, but maybe not. Yeah, I'll put them above Spanish. They have the light cav with the extra pierce armor is nice. And they have some decent options, but very little eco bonus. The gold is helpful, yes, but yeah, not the most crazy Civ ever. Vietnamese are great, in my opinion. They're probably even better than Tatar slightly. I really, really like the Vietnamese. Being able to see your opponent's DC from the start is great. The extra HP on archers and skirms is phenomenal. Cav archers is a big option for Vietnamese. Rattan archers is amazing. You get Halb, you get Arbalest, you get Bomber Cannon, you get Siege Engineers, and the list goes on with Vietnamese. I really like the Civ. In fact, it could even go higher if these Civs weren't like absolutely monsters. And next up we have Vikings, which I'll probably place above Vietnamese. And Vikings have a great economy, although they lack late game options. Well, actually, Vikings might be worse than Vietnamese and Tatars, though, to be honest. Their late game just lacks a little bit too much. I'll probably put them right here. Great economy, but late game is lacking, and they're a little bit predictable with what they go for. But overall, they are definitely a force to be reckoned with. So that's pretty much it for my tier list. I'm going to go ahead and balance things out a little bit, probably. So I'll probably drop Japanese down to B tier, Saracens down to B tier, and then I'll probably drop Bengalis down to C tier, and that would look like a little bit more. D tier. And that will look like a little bit more of a balanced tier list. And I'm pretty happy with that one. I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope you guys are, in agreement with me, and if not, let me know in the comments if you agree or disagree with it. And yeah, thank you so much for watching. This is the current patch tier list after KOTD, so it's definitely pretty credible. We've had a lot of information from King of the Desert and a lot of Arabia games being played. So yeah, thanks for watching. Make sure to like, comment, subscribe if you enjoyed it, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Peace.